Thank you for joining us today for the first webinar in our RTI and Early Childhood webinar series. We're excited to be hosting the series, and we're glad you're watching. My name is Christina Davis, and I am the Marketing Manager for Early Childhood Books at Brooks Publishing. Today's webinar will provide an overview of RTI and how it is designed to work within a range of early childhood settings. Dr. Virginia Buysse and Dr. Ellen Peisner-Feinberg, editors of the Handbook of Response to Early Intervention, are with us today to present the webinar. Dr. Buysse is Senior Scientist at the Frank Porter Graham Child Development Institute at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. In addition to directing a program of research on recognition and response, a model of response to intervention for pre-kindergarten, her research interests include innovations in professional development, models such as consultation, coaching, mentoring, and communities of practice that support professional development and program improvement, and educational practices and interventions that address the unique needs of diverse learners, those who have disabilities, who have learning difficulties, or who are dual language learners. Also presenting is Dr. Ellen Peisner-Feinberg. She is a senior scientist at the Frank Porter Graham Child Development Institute at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill with Dr. Buysse. Her background is in developmental psychology and public policy, and she has more than 20 years of research experience in early childhood education and program evaluation. Dr. Peisner-Feinberg has conducted numerous statewide and national research studies focused on the quality of early education programs and initiatives, the effects on children, especially dual language learners and children at risk, and quality improvement strategies. The audience is eager to hear about your presentation, so you can begin now.
Hello, my name is Virginia Buysse. Today, my colleague Ellen Peisner-Feinberg and I will be presenting an overview on response to intervention in early childhood. The title of our talk is RTI, Conceptual Foundations for the Early Childhood Field. This is the first presentation in a series of webinars that Brooks is sponsoring on this topic, as was mentioned. This session is designed to touch on some of the big ideas and set the stage for future presentations that will delve a little deeper into various aspects of response to intervention in early childhood. In the K-12 world, response to intervention has been around for more than a decade, but this is still a very new idea in early childhood, where the field lacks practice definitions and guidelines and the resources and experience in implementing this approach with younger children in early care and education programs prior to kindergarten. Different terms are being used for response to intervention, both in K-12 and as it applies to younger children in pre-K. These are some of the terms that you may have heard and wondered about. Response to intervention, response to instruction, multi-tiered system of supports, positive behavioral interventions and supports, tiered instruction, and my personal favorite, RTI squared. Essentially, all of these terms refer to the idea of organizing instruction by tiers or levels of intensity, from least to most intensive. More on that in just a minute. But first, what are the origins of this approach? Let's consider a few sources for just a minute. Response to intervention originated with the public health prevention model, where the primary prevention level translated to core instruction for all children within school-based RTI models, and secondary prevention practices translated to targeted interventions for some children in the RTI model in schools. And the tertiary prevention level translated into more intensive interventions for a few children. So I think this shows the correspondence between the public health model and the school-based RTI model. Another figure, the one that is displayed here, that's widely used to describe response to intervention, shows that the approach is applicable to address both academic learning and behavioral issues. In 2012, the National Professional Development Center on Inclusion presented this framework for thinking about what RTI would look like in early childhood. And as you can see here in this slide, it includes core curriculum and intentional teaching for all children, targeted interventions and supports for some children, and more intensive individualized interventions and supports for a few children. Recognition and response is a widely recognized model of RTI to promote academic learning in pre-K. And the teaching pyramid is a widely recognized model of positive behavioral supports, or RTI, to promote social-emotional development in early childhood. Some of the terms used within RTI are new or confusing. Other terms are familiar terms, but they're being used to mean something different within RTI. Let's look at some of these terms. Problem solving. Within RTI, problem solving means working collaboratively with parents, teachers, based on formative assessment results. Generally, programs establish problem-solving teams that work together to review assessment results and determine which children might benefit from receiving additional instructional supports and to monitor their progress in learning. Instruction and intervention. Instruction means the general curriculum and intentional teaching that all children receive. Intervention means the instructional or behavioral supports that some children receive based on formative assessment results. All children receive core instruction. Some children also receive additional behavioral and instructional supports, and a few receive additional supports that are even more intensive and individualized. So in this way, tiered instruction is really an additive model. Small group instruction. Within RTI, small groups mean explicit instruction targeting key skills for some children as part of a tiered instructional system. Outside of RTI, small groups involve learning activities such as the book center, the art area, writing table, or dramatic play to address broad curriculum goals for all children. The formative assessment component of RTI helps teachers determine which children might benefit from explicit small group instruction that targets key skills in language, literacy, or math.
Let me share some more definitions with you. Assessment within RTI goes under the term of formative assessment. And by that, we mean assessment that's gathered by teachers and used to guide instructional decisions. Within RTI, we talk about a specific type of screening that's used called universal screening. By that, we mean using formative assessment with all children in a classroom to determine whether some children need more instructional supports. This differs from developmental screening, which refers to assessment that's used to determine whether further diagnostic evaluation is needed. Progress monitoring within RTI refers to the use of formative assessment to determine how children are responding to the core instruction and targeted interventions that are provided and whether adjustments are needed. Three terms that are often confused are curriculum-based measures, general outcome measures, and curriculum-based assessment. Curriculum-based measures are used within RTI, and these refer to brief measures of key academic skills linked to later reading and math achievement. General outcome measures are another term for CBMs, and curriculum-based assessments refer to assessments linked to the learning goals of a specific curriculum. Three defining features of RTI in early childhood are formative assessment, foundational instructions and tiered interventions, and supports for decision making and implementation. features that are shared in common with school-age RTI models. Two widely used models of RTI for pre-K that Virginia mentioned earlier are recognition and response, or R&R, and the pyramid model. The first model, recognition response, is focused on academic learning, while the pyramid model is focused on socio-emotional development. Let me share a little brief overview with you of the recognition and response model as an example of how this approach to RTI would operate in early childhood settings. This tiered instructional model has three tiers. At the first tier, or tier one, we talk about foundational instruction for all children. There's a research-based core curriculum and intentional teaching at the instructional component and formative assessment used with all children. At tier two, for some children, based on formative assessment results who are struggling to learn, we provide explicit small group interventions and embedded learning activities. At tier three, for children who still need additional instructional supports, we provide individualized scaffolding strategies along with continued formative assessment to monitor their progress. This is all supported by collaborative problem solving to help teachers implement the model. Is there any evidence to support RTI? What do we know about it? Well, there's a growing body of evidence in the K-12 world. Some key resources to support this are a meta-analysis of 24 studies and IES practice guides both in reading and in math. However, the research is still emerging in the pre-K world. Similarly, there is federal legislation addressing the use of RTI for kindergarten through 12th grade, including specific provisions within IDEA related to the use of RTI and positive behavioral supports, but there are no provisions for pre-K. As pre-K programs begin to think about implementing RTI, they may have many questions and are looking for guidance. These questions may include things like what practices define RTI around assessment, instruction, and intervention. Who implements RTI? Teachers, of course, but also what's the role of specialists, administrators, and even parents? Which children and families are affected by RTI? Some practices may affect all children. Some may be implemented with just a target group. Who benefits from RTI? Hopefully everyone benefits, both those on the program side, teachers and administrators, as well as the children and families. And how does RTI fit with existing practices around assessment and instruction and intervention? What can be changed, added, and removed? It's a lot to think about. Luckily, there's a new resource out that can help you think about all of these practices. The Handbook of Response to Intervention in Early Childhood that's been recently published has a number of chapters and sections that can help you think about this. It talks about the foundations of RTI in early childhood, talks about assessment practices within RTI, curriculum and instruction, program level supports for implementing RTI in early childhood, and finally future challenges and new directions. And now I will turn it over to Christina to tell you what else is planned for the webinar series.
Yes, so it will continue this fall, and I hope that some of you or most of you have registered for the additional webinars. The next one is going to be on RTI and its role in early mathematics, presented by Dr. Ginsberg, and that will be Monday, October 21st. There's also a webinar on assessing preschooler social, emotional, and behavioral skills, which is on the 24th of October, statewide structures and supports for implementing RTI on the 28th of October, and we're going to round out the fall series with the role of RTI in addressing the learning needs of young DLLs, which is on Monday, November 4th. And then in the spring, we're going to continue the webinar series on RTI in early childhood. The topics that we're going to address are formative assessment, recognition and response model, which you learned about earlier in the presentation a little bit, so we're going to dive more into that, the pyramid model, and language and literacy instruction. So I encourage you to register for any and all of these webinars, and they are all free, and you can do so by visiting the link that is on your slide. And also, just to go over back up about the handbook that was shown to you, I wanted to let you know quickly before we get into the question and answer session that as part of the series, we're offering a special 20% discount on the handbook of response to intervention. So if you jot down the code RTIEC20, you can use it to get 20% off of the book, and the offer is good till the end of next June, so you have some time. If you're interested in this book, and hopefully you will join us for the rest of the webinars, which cover topics within the handbook. So now we can turn to questions that were submitted by the audience. Who should be implementing RTI in pre-K settings? Teachers? Specialists?
Well, generally, it is the classroom teacher who has the primary responsibility for implementing tiered instruction. So you can think of this approach as a way to help teachers improve the instruction they're already providing to young children. And they do this by gathering information on all children and use it to customize instruction to address each child's learning needs. The collaborative problem-solving component offers opportunities for parents, specialists, and administrators to be involved, but it is really the teacher who leads and facilitates this process.
Okay. Another question we received, what tools are available for use with younger children for progress monitoring? If we already use several different assessments, can we just use the ones we already have been using for this purpose?
Well, the assessment tools that are used within an RTI framework really need to have certain kinds of properties that they are used particularly for instructional planning. So what that means is that they need to be able to be used repeatedly over time, typically 3 times a year on a fall, winter, spring schedule. They also need to be able to be direct assessments of children's skills, and so that means actually doing a direct administration to see specifically what a child knows as opposed to just a survey or something like that. It also needs to be in particular content areas of interest. So for example, language and literacy skills or math skills. They need to predict later achievement on the part of children. So predict to later have evidence of predicting to later reading skills or later math skills, for example. They need to be quick and easy to administer, so take no more than, say, 5 to 10 minutes per child. It's something that teachers are going to be doing with all of the children in their classroom, so clearly we don't want those to take too long. And they need to be able to provide information on both the level and the rate of growth. There are a lot of tools out there for the K-12 world. There are not a lot of tools available in the pre-K world. At this point, we're really aware of really just a couple of tools out there that have been used or have been appropriate to use in pre-K. Specifically, those would be the IGDIS, the Individual Growth and Development Indicators, and the CPALS Plus. The circled preschool assessment for language and literacy skills. And both of those actually have measurements of language literacy and math available.
Okay. Thank you. So another one of our audience members had a question about children in their Head Start classroom. They all need individualized instruction to learn key readiness skills, and so the listener wants to know how they can implement an RTI approach when everybody needs the same thing.
Teachers do want to meet the needs of every child in their classroom. I think that's something we can all appreciate and applaud. I think what this model can do, this approach, is really to help teachers be more efficient in the way that they accomplish that goal. I think sometimes teachers are surprised by the formative assessment results. They may think that all children need to learn the exact same concepts and skills, but the assessments show considerable variability in children's skills in terms of their vocabulary skills, their phonological awareness, letter knowledge, and math concepts, and so forth. And so when teachers look at the distributions of scores when you actually rank order them, they see that there's quite a bit of variability and that some children fall kind of at the top of that rank order, some children fall in the middle, and some children are at the lower end of it. And so these results and this information can be used by teachers to really target their instructional supports and make sure that the right children get them. And so I think that tiered instruction is a way to help teachers who want to address children's individual needs do that more systematically and more efficiently.
Perfect. So on to the next question. How do you figure out which children need tiered instruction and which children don't need it?
Well, that's where the information from the screening results really comes in. And when you think about it, the whole idea behind this is that you're trying to figure out which are the children who really need additional help, who are struggling to learn just from the basic curriculum that's already being provided to these children. And you're trying to use your screening results using data to systematically figure that out. There are really two different approaches to doing that. One is when the measures themselves, the assessment tools themselves, have already established cut points, what's called cut points, for figuring that out. And that's where the measures have these large norming samples that tell you if a child scores in this kind of range, that's really an indication that they're going to be a struggling learner. These are not really, this is not really an approach that's yet been very well established with these tools in early childhood, although they are starting to move in that direction, although it is a very common approach with older children. The other approach is what's called a local norms approach, and that's where you say, well, let me look within this particular classroom or within this particular school and say, who are the children relative to their peers who are really struggling, who are really our lowest performers, who have the lowest scores compared to their peers, and that's how you choose the children. Either way, it's still a data-based decision. In addition, then, I think the second part of that question is to say, okay, now I've figured out my children based on the screening results of everybody who are going to be the target group for Tier 2 supports. Then the question is, okay, now I've got that group, we're doing Tier 2 supports with those children. Then how do you figure out, okay, for whom is that still not sufficient? Who might need additional further Tier 3 supports? And that's where you essentially take the same approach, that you look at assessment results, you look at continued progress monitoring data, and you say, okay, who's not making sufficient progress? Who's making very little progress over the course of the intervention period? Even with the additional Tier 2 supports along with the continued Tier 1 curriculum, and you say, okay, those are the children then who still need more, that we're providing the Tier 1 instruction, We're providing the Tier 2 interventions and supports, and they're still not making the kind of progress that you would expect to see. That's where you say then, these are the children who then you add on additional Tier 3 supports. So again, you use the data to make those decisions.
Great, that makes perfect sense. So the next question is about involving parents and other specialists and therapists in the process. So what is the best way to make sure they're all involved?
Well, the collaborative problem-solving component of response to intervention is really designed to do just that. It offers a process by which teachers, parents, specialists, and administrators can work together to plan instructional supports and assess how well children respond to them. Now, early childhood programs may not have a collaborative problem-solving component already established, but I'm guessing that there are some aspects already in place around communicating with families and other professionals and working with them. And so programs can start with what's already in place and build on that. We recommend that early childhood professionals begin by developing a plan for communicating with parents and others about tiered instruction that they are providing in the classroom. At the beginning of the year, teachers should communicate with families in writing to let them know about the formative assessment and instructional components that they are implementing in the classroom so that families understand exactly what's happening and aren't surprised later in the process when teachers meet with them and share information. In addition, they should consider ways of involving families in interpreting assessment results and making decisions about implementing additional instructional supports with families and specialists and others. When there are special concerns about a particular child's progress, teachers should consider meeting with parents to discuss what strategies are working and to figure out what might need to change to address the child's learning goals. Together, teachers and parents can determine the best way to share information and stay in touch with each other.
Okay. So the next question, I think, will involve a little bit more of a larger response. So a program is looking to start, moving to an RTI approach in their public pre-K program. So can you give some recommendations as to how the program would get started?
Sure. In terms of getting started, often we recommend that you really need to think about a 1 to 2 year planning process. That this is really a program-wide thing that needs to be adopted, that in order to implement RTI, you need administrative support. It's not really something that just a single teacher could think about doing on her own in her classroom. We recommend the program start by establishing a planning team, thinking about that including administrators, teachers, specialists, parents, thinking about who you want on that team. That team needs to make a number of key decisions. So thinking about things like, where are you going to introduce this? Do you want to start out by just having demonstration sites? Do you want to try it in all of your classrooms? Do you want to try it in all of your facilities or just some of your programs? What sort of time frame do you want for planning? How will you make your decisions? You need to decide about that. How will information be communicated to key stakeholders? You also need to think about how this will fit within your existing context in terms of the policies that are currently in place, any initiatives you have going on, your current resources that are available to support this, the current standards that are in place for your program. You need to come up with a plan for how readiness for implementation will be determined. How will you know that a classroom or a site is actually ready to begin to implement RTI? You also need to think about a number of issues around the implementation itself. What tools will be selected for assessment and curriculum and intervention? How will the collaborative problem-solving process be organized? Who will participate? How will that be structured? Who will be involved in the whole implementation process, and in what roles will they be involved? What is the plan for professional development and ongoing support? Who will oversee that? Who will implement that? How will you know if the whole process is working? What will be the ways that you will evaluate and measure that? And finally, what will your plan be for communicating with families, specialists, and administrators about the R&R process, the RNTI process? So there's a lot to think about with implementing a plan for RTI. There's a lot to plan. There's a lot to do. But the work that we've done would suggest that it's a worthwhile process to engage in.
Right. I'll just add to that that in the work that we've done around the country, where we have seen this work very well is when there's strong leadership in place.
Absolutely.
So when you have an administrator, for example, who really decides that moving to an RTI or tiered instructional approach is really the way to go, and that person steps up to the plate and really provides the leadership, then things really start to happen. So I think that is a key. And then the other thing I would mention is technology is really important. And that keeps changing.
Huh. Yes.
And we live in a world where, the technology is changing rapidly every day. There are some very exciting developments that make gathering assessments on children so much easier. We're moving much more to using computer tablets, for example. Teachers love them, and one of the reasons they love them is because, well, they're fun to use, but it's because it's so easy to gather the information, to upload it, and to then, access it and use it in ways that are very helpful to teachers. So the technology is really key in terms of, helping people move to adopting this kind of approach and really embracing it. And the professional development is also very key. This is not something you can do by just basically reading about it in some kind of a manual or a set of guidelines. You really need good, intensive professional development and ongoing support through coaching or mentoring or consultation. So I'll just second everything Ellen said. And there's so much more we could say on this topic of how do you begin planning for implementation. And it really takes a lot of thought and a lot of different minds all working together.
Absolutely. I think just one other thing I'll add to that we've seen as well is that, and I think it's something you've heard mentioned in our talk today, that there's a lot more that's been done to this point in the field with school-age RTI. Early childhood is just beginning. There's a lot of things that are different about this with early childhood just because the whole world of early childhood is different. But that's not to say that we can't learn a lot from school age and that can't be a valuable resource to people in early childhood that are looking to implement RTI in their programs. And so I think that's another piece that we found that can often be valuable is when they have collaborators in the school age world that can help provide useful resources to them as well in terms of lessons learned.
Great. And furthering on about the leadership and implementation, just a reminder, you will learn more about that in our webinar presented on October 28th. Just to, in case you didn't catch that earlier, there will be a whole webinar dedicated to implementation, so for those of you who are interested. So one of the viewers wants to know if you can speak more about the similarities and differences between RTI and the pyramid model.
Sure, I'll start. Maybe Ellen can add her thoughts as well. Essentially, the similarities are that they're both tiered models in terms of thinking about organizing the instructional or behavioral supports by level of intensity, from least to most intensive. So they share that. They have that in common. I think they are different, and the main difference is that the recognition and response model really focuses on academic learning in the areas of language, literacy, and mathematics. And the pyramid model really focuses on challenging behaviors and social-emotional development. So that's a key difference. A couple of other differences that I can just think of off the top of my head relate to formative assessment. With respect to recognition response, Ellen has mentioned a couple of widely available tools that can be used for that purpose. These assessments are designed to really gather information on what children know and what they can do. That really is useful in making decisions about whether or not they need additional supports. On the social-emotional side, I think it's more difficult to find formative assessment tools that are used to directly assess the children's strengths and areas of need. And so there are teacher rating tools that can be used. There are tools that really focus on how the practices get implemented in terms of the pyramid model. But the direct assessment of children's behavioral characteristics or needs just isn't there. And that's just not in that model. That's also true of the K-12 world. This is just a key difference between positive behavioral supports and response to intervention. Of course, the interventions are going to be different because they're targeting different domains. On the one side, academic learning, you're going to think about small group instruction, which is much more well-suited to focusing on helping children learn language and literacy skills, for example, or math concepts. I think that whole idea doesn't work as well when you're thinking about helping children who has challenging behaviors. A small group instruction may or may not be the best way to address that. So the interventions tend to be different as well. So those are some of the big differences and some similarities that I can think of. Anything to add, Ellen?
Yeah, I think I think Virginia really hit on the very key points there. I think the only thing I would add to that is a direction that we'd like to see this all go in the future is to really think about ways to merge these areas and to see models where you can actually have both academic learning and behavioral challenges taken into account in a single model, and that's something we'd like to see happen in our future work.
Okay. Somebody is actually interested to know about research projects. Do you have any that are underway in the area of RTI and pre-K, or any you're working on that you want to tell the audience about?
Sure. We have completed several studies on recognition and response as it applies to language and literacy with funding from the Emily Hall Tremaine Foundation, which is a small family foundation, as well as from the Institute for Education Sciences within the U.S. Department of Education. And currently, we have a grant from the U.S. Department of Education, IES, to focus on recognition and response as it relates to mathematics in pre-K. So that's what we're working on right now, a new application. We are working on software that will be used on a computer tablet that teachers can use for the formative assessment component. The interventions will focus both on what happens at Tier 1. What we're learning is teachers are really interested in math instruction, but they don't really have a lot going on at Tier 1 other than what they can kind of devise on their own. They don't really have access to good resources, sound curricula, and so we're trying to help them in terms of just having a good foundation in place for Tier 1 before we move to helping them think about targeted interventions at Tiers 2 and 3. That's what we're working on this year. We're in a development phase, and next year we will be doing a small pilot study. So that's where we are. And, of course, writing grant proposals and hoping to have more funding in the future.
Great. So there is another question about implementing one RTI model for academic and social-emotional learning. Can you talk about that?
I think that's the idea that Ellen just mentioned of, the idea of having one integrated model. I think most people would agree that would be ideal because we don't want teachers implementing multiple tiered approaches at one time. Kind of feels like a juggling act, and that's not really very feasible. So it's the ideal. I would say we don't yet have the funding, the resources even to help us figure out what that model would look like. I think it's really ripe in terms of the need for future efforts to be focused on it and future research. But about all we can say is it's something that is desirable. I'm not even aware of an existing integrated approach that I could point to in the K-12 world. Some states actually have multi-tiered systems of supports that are statewide that do attempt to think about both the behavioral support side as well as the academic learning side. I believe Michigan is one example of that kind of an approach. But in terms of a specific model for early childhood, we're just not there yet.
Okay. So I think that if we can continue the discussion offline, if anybody has more questions that they think about, after the presentation, or if you've had time to kind of absorb it all. I don't know if you have anything last minute things to add, Dr. Buysse or Dr. Peisner-Feinberg.
Not at this time. Thank you for the opportunity.
Great. So, again, on behalf of Brooks and Dr. Buysse and Dr. Peisner-Feinberg, I thank you for joining us, and I hope to see you on one of our future webinars.